The 9th-ranked Cowboys take on the 16th-ranked Baylor Bears in Waco. Cowgirl cross country had a historic week, and Cowgirl softball's fall ball started up. All this and more on the Poke Report. Hello everyone and welcome to the first week of the Poke Report. I'm Alex Dusky.
And I'm Jace Andrews. It's a great weekend for some Cowboy football and we'll get into more of that in just a moment.
We are here in Waco, Texas. We will be covering the OSU-Baylor game tomorrow and we will talk plenty about that game, but first we have a great show for you guys today.
Let's start off with some Cowboy football and what they did on their bye week. As a reminder, they defeated Arkansas Pine Bluff just 2 weeks ago. Since then, they've been preparing for this matchup with Baylor. Our own Rowdy Baribeau has been following the team this past week.
Following their bye week, the Oklahoma State Cowboys are looking ahead to their conference schedule starting with Baylor this Saturday. For the Cowboys, their week was about reps and preparing for Baylor quarterback Blake Shapen their second time around.
We worked the young guys last week, which I shared with you, and then continued to try to improve on just our base in all three phases. And then started on Baylor a little bit on Thursday. And then obviously we'll be into Baylor tomorrow.
In last year's Big 12 championship game, Baylor rolled out a youngster and true freshman quarterback Blake Shapen, and in his third career start, he propelled the Bears to their first Big 12 title since 2014. Shapen played well enough as a freshman to earn the starting job this year and has Baylor sitting at 3-1 going into week 5. Cowboy defensive end Brock Martin had nothing but praise for the young Baylor quarterback.
Well, I mean, he played in 2-3 games last year, 4 games. So, I mean, we got some more film on him. He looks like he's a little bit more comfortable. You know, he's a tough kid. He's taken some licks and gotten up and, you know, came back in, played, thrown the ball like nothing happened to him.
Shapen had his way with the Cowboys last year, throwing for 180 yards while completing just over 82% of his passes. Shapen also threw for all 3 of the Bears' touchdowns in the contest. Shapen's completion percentage and efficiency passing the ball was a key reason the Bears were able to walk out of AT&T Stadium as kings of the Big 12. OSU cornerback Corey Black feels like the defense is prepared for Shapen on their second go-around.
You know, obviously we watch film about it, film over and everything. You know, we just get to do a focus on, you know, what we got to work on and focus on our keys during the game and, you know, just communicate. And that's how we go on.
The Cowboys are 2.5 favorites against the Bears as they travel to Waco. For the Poke Report, I'm Rowdy Baribeau.
Thank you, Rowdy. There's a lot at stake in tomorrow's matchup, and we'll be previewing more about it in the future.
Cowgirl Golf finished up play at the Schooner Fall Invitational on Monday, and they had a great performance. The team totaled a 273 in the final round at Belmar Golf Club in Norman. The third place finish brings the Cowgirls to 18 consecutive top 3 finishes in regular season tournaments dating back to October of 2020. Sophomore Clemence Martin made her return to tournament action following an injury she suffered in March. She led the Cowgirls throughout and shot 8-under to tie for a third-place finish, carding for 16 birdies. A standout performance by Rina Tatsumatsu on Monday led to a resilient final round to tie for 20th at even par. The Cowgirls led the field in par 4 scoring and eagles, only trailing Florida State in total birdies. Cowgirl Golf resumes play at Medina Country Club at the Illini Women's Invitational starting on October 10th.
Meanwhile, the Cowboy Golf team finished their opening tournament this past weekend. The team finished the Fighting Illini Invitational on Sunday with a 287 over 3 rounds. The Cowboys finished 7th. 5th year Rasmus Neergaard Peterson placed 9th, finishing even par. Some other key members including junior Bo Jin, who finished 216, and senior Hazen Newman finished with a 217. The team will be back in action on Monday when they play in Fort Worth. Another team that is just getting their season started is Cowgirl Soccer. Griff McClellan has the recap.
The Oklahoma State Cowgirls soccer team continues to dominate opponents this season, this time defeating the Kansas Jayhawks and Kansas State Wildcats to open Big 12 play on the road. OSU improved its record to 9-1-1 on the season. Cowgirl forward Olivia Dowell and goalie Jordan Nitez reflected on the team's recent success.
I definitely think just energy, just bringing energy and working hard, outworking our opponents. Like you said, like we've only given up 4 goals all season so far. And so just working super hard defensively is going to translate offense.
I think just our will to like want to be able to play for each other and win. Like when you go out on the field and you really just want it, like if there's this drive, this want, this desire, then that's when the actual soccer starts to come in. And that's when the effort, that's when it really shows. And that's what's going to continue to help us win games.
Following their road trip to Kansas, the Cowgirls have now recorded 5 shutouts in their last 6 games. Head coach Colin Carmichael discussed his team's goals and expectations as the season progresses.
We just go week by week. If you catch yourself looking too far ahead, you're going to overlook something that you shouldn't. So, you know, we talked going into last weekend's games, the intensity ramps up, the familiarity of all the coaches and programs goes up as well. So there's just that little bit of an extra edge in these Big 12 games. So we talked about that last week, and we handled it really well on the road. And so this week, all we're talking about is Texas Tech.
OSU will host the Texas Tech Red Raiders Thursday in its Big 12 home opener, seeking its 10th win of the season. For the Poke Report, I'm Griff McClellan.
Thanks, Griff. Good thing the Wildcats and the Jayhawks are good at football.
Cowgirl Cross Country is off and running. Our own Adam Engel has the recap of last week's meet.
Winning a race in your college debut is a rare accomplishment. Not for OSU freshman Natalie Cook. On Saturday, the number 2 ranked Cowgirls cross country team won the Cowboy Jamboree at the Griner Family OSU Cross Country Course. Cook entered college as the top high school runner, and the success continues. She finished first in 20 minutes and 17 seconds and beat All-American teammate Taylor Rowe. Cook says she was excited with her performance.
I didn't really know what to expect. I came in here with no expectations. Yeah, I had a good high school career, but this is college, and it's a long season, so I'm excited what's up next, and I know that we're just getting started.
OSU cross country coach Dave Smith says he recognizes the luxury he has in Rowe and Cook.
I mean, she's obviously incredibly talented. She's very competitive, and I think, you know, having Taylor there with her to kind of help chaperone her through, and, you know, we knew that we had 2 women probably going to finish in the top 5. Any given day, those 2 women can flip-flop who's going to be ahead and who's going to be behind.
For the number 4 ranked Cowboys, Alex Meyer won the race, and the team finished 4th. Meyer, a senior who runs 120 miles a week, clocked the 2nd fastest time in Cowboy Jamboree history. Smith says the rest of the country needs to watch out for Meyer.
He's firing a shot across the bow to the rest of the NCAA. He doesn't get a lot of, probably not a lot of respect, and people don't recognize how good he is and how well he's done recently.
As a result of the performances, Cook and Meyer became Big 12 and National Runners of the Week. Now the cross country team will be back in action right here at the Griner Family Cross Country Course on October 15th for the Weiss Crockett Invitational. And guys, a month later, on November 19th, OSU will host the National Championship. The men, the Cowboys, finished 3rd last year but are looking for the top spot this year. Folks, it's a great time to be a cross country fan in Stillwater. For Poke Report, I'm Adam Engel.
I agree, Adam. It is a great time to be a cross-country fan. Now, Jace, I don't know about you, but I am really excited for the NCAA championships coming to Stillwater in November.
Oh, for sure. Do you think it's too late for me to run with them?
Probably, but I would check with Adam Engel. He'd probably know.
Well, we're going to take a quick break, but when we come back, we'll have more information on OSU sports and club sports.
I want to show you something. This is the money we could save by switching from fresh-packed California crushed tomatoes to concentrated tomato paste.
I want to show you something, too. I got a new door. Go take a look at it.
Nobody uses better ingredients than Little Caesars, like fresh-packed California crushed tomatoes. Pick up a large, deep dish for just $8.
Pizza, pizza. Introducing Lincoln Black Label at Diffie Ford Lincoln. Designed to impress those with impeccable taste, Lincoln Black Label features a collection of interior themes and a host of exclusive membership privileges, inspired by attention to detail and a love of automobiles. With Lincoln Black Label, you'll enjoy an extended premium maintenance plan that covers wear items or even remote vehicle delivery. Lincoln Black Label isn't about luxury ownership, it's about membership. Lincoln Black Label, exclusively at Diffie Ford Lincoln.
At ASAP Energy, our goal is to provide the best customer service for whatever our clients need.
My relationship with ASAP Energy came about in 2007. I was wanting to build a convenience store. I didn't know how to do it. I had never been in the business. I just felt comfortable with Rick. And so I knew that I wanted to do business with a guy like that. Integrity, loyalty, and family. I would recommend that to anybody. Thanks for taking a chance on me.
At ASAP Energy, everything matters.
Where were you born? It's a question asked all the time. Because where you're from shapes who you are, inspires how you do things. And when that inspiration comes from a place this refreshing, this majestic, this, well, you get the idea. Coors Light, born in the Rockies.
Welcome back to the Poke Report. I'm Jace Andrews.
And I'm Alex Dusky. We've talked about four campus sports so far, but we still have a lot more to discuss.
Up next, we're going to take a look at a century-long rivalry that will be coming to an end after a bunch of iconic moments. Bedlam. After 116 matchups between OU and OSU, the rivalry will come to an end as OU joins the SEC. While this rivalry has been around since 1904, it gives the opportunity for new rivalries to be born.
It takes time for rivalries to really be formed. There'll be some great games and some spirited competition, maybe games deciding a conference championship.
The rivalry goes beyond the football field. It's a tradition between these two universities. It's a time of year where everyone gets together and everyone looks forward to Bedlam. We don't know exactly when OU and Texas will be leaving the conference, but when they do, OSU will be looking towards new rivalries.
We're going to take a look into what's happening in Gallagher-Iba Arena. Our own Ben Cohen has a scoop on Cowboy basketball.
Basketball season is right around the corner. The Cowboy basketball schedule was released last week through this video of Coach Boynton and his kids. The Cowboys have been preparing all summer for this season. Senior guard Avery Anderson went through the NBA draft process, and it taught him the areas of his game that he needs to improve on.
Just to play like 35 minutes, you need to be conditioned, and I feel like last year I wasn't as conditioned as I could be, so I feel like if I really work on that this year, I could make better plays and smarter plays and not get tired.
Chris Harris Jr. has also been putting in work. Harris suffered a season-ending knee injury in the 2020 season opener, which also kept him sidelined for the 2021-2022 season.
I feel great. 100% cleared. I'm just ready to get out there and just show y'all like the stuff I've been working on, just trying to show y'all that I'm the same Chris, or even better.
The first official practice happened right here on Monday in Gallagher-Iba Arena. GIA is one of the most historic arenas in the nation, and the Cowboys look to continue their winning success this season.
And I feel like we've stabilized the program. We've got an ignited, excited, encouraged fan base. This place deserves a winning basketball program, and it's my job right now to lead the program to success, and hopefully we can get 13,611 people in here as often as possible to watch us win some games.
This season will consist of many different lineup combinations. Caleb Boone hinted that he will be playing power forward for the first time in his career, and will share the court with Musa Cisse or Tyreek Smith. The Cowboys acquired key pieces this offseason. Transfer senior Caleb Asbury is a 40% three-point shooter that will certainly help with the shooting struggles of last year's team. John Michael Wright, transfer from High Point University, will be taking over the point guard position previously held by Isaac Likely. And freshman guard Keon Williams has impressed the coaches and players with his energy. For the Poke Report, I'm Ben Cohen.
Thank you, Ben. You know, you mentioned Avery Anderson and Chris Harris Jr. Those guys have both been here since my freshman year on campus, so I'm definitely looking forward to seeing them on the court.
Let's move past the basketball court and into the arena. Our own Asa Lucas takes a deeper dive into the gamers of OSU.
One event in 2021 had more views than the Oscars, NBA Finals, World Series, and College Football Championship put together. Do you know what it was? That would be the 2021 League of Legends World Championship, with over 73 million views. So, with the popularity of esports, I decided to see what teams or community OSU offered for those interested, which led me to the esports arena in the basement of the Student Union. There I met one of the coordinators for Counter-Strike Global Offensive in GOSU, or Gamers of Oklahoma State University, Campbell Waxel. He explained to me the structure of GOSU.
GOSU is a group of students that are trying to further gaming on campus in every facet. So they're trying to have competitive events to further our really competitive players that want to win, but they're also trying to show people that there's other parts to it. So our streaming, casting, coaches, production, all that other stuff that goes into it is really where I think where GOSU thrives and where we have a lot of ability that even other gaming clubs may not have at OSU, or at other universities, rather.
But Campbell isn't the only one who found a community within GOSU. Aaron King, a student at Oklahoma State, also found friendship and a passion.
So I would definitely say you get to, one, you meet a bunch of people on campus very quickly through GOSU. You don't feel alone initially, because usually when you go to college, you don't have a lot of friends. Being an OSU student, especially with GOSU, being, I guess, a gamer of OSU with the jersey and everything, it makes you feel connected.
So with all these building blocks in place and the newfound success for the gamers of OSU, it only means one thing. They're not going to have a problem leveling up. For the Poke Report, I'm Asa Lucas.
Thanks, Asa. If you'd like to learn more about GOSU, then you can check out their Twitter at Gamers of OSU.
Getting back into OSU sports, Cowgirl tennis dominated in two tournaments last week. Down in Lubbock, Raquel Gonzalez advanced to the singles quarterfinals, and All-American duo in Ayumi Miyamoto and Lisa Marie Rue advanced to the doubles semifinals. Unfortunately, no Cowgirls won a championship, but the season is still young. At the Battle of the Bay, Christina Novak and Sofia Rojas also found success on the court. Christina fell short to the number one seed in the championship, but the team still has a lot to be proud of their performance in San Francisco. The Cowgirls will continue to play this week at two ITA tournaments in California and North Carolina. We're going to take one more quick break, but don't go away. Poke Report will be back shortly.
The deli department at Homeland is Oklahoma's headquarters for party trays. Enjoy the time with family and friends at your next event, and let your neighborhood Homeland create the perfect fruit, deli, or cheese tray for you. The party planners at Homeland will help you choose the perfect party food, sized just right for your guests. Call us, stop in, or order online, and we'll make it ready for pickup on your schedule. Make your next party special with a party tray from your neighborhood Homeland.
Good to be home, Homeland.
Love these things. Hilarious. I'm sorry, force of habit.
As long as you are you, it's Miller time.
Hi, it's Sam at Louie's Grill and Bar, here to introduce our new menu items from south of the border. Come try our new Poblano Chicken Tacos or the ever-popular Sriracha Shrimp Tacos. At Louie's, where you come for the food, but stay for the fun.
It's hard to imagine my life before her, or a day without her. So much of what I take for granted simply wouldn't exist. She is the force that holds our life together. She is my everything. The center of my universe from Forevermark. The diamond, the promise. Available at Lewis Jewelers.
I'm Randy Heights with 107.7 The Franchise, and let me tell you about the HCG diet from New Leaf Wellness and what it's meant to me. Over the last year, I've dropped 90 pounds, and this has been a lifesaver, guys. I'm in a wheelchair, so I can't always get to the gym, and what's been incredible about this diet? When I can't work out, I still lose the weight. 90 pounds in a year is a lot for anyone, but for me, it's been a miracle. Why don't you give New Leaf Wellness Centers a call and see if they can't help you with a free consultation, or go online at newleafcenters.com.
Welcome back to the Poke Report. Thank you for staying with us.
As we mentioned earlier, Big 12 conference play kicked off last week, and man, it did not disappoint. Starting off with neighboring rival Oklahoma. They were at home facing off against Kansas State, who was looking to defeat the Sooners for the third time in 4 years. Quarterback Adrian Martinez started his night off hot, rushing for a 6-yard touchdown. He followed that up with his first passing touchdown of the season, putting his Wildcats up 14-0 over the Sooners. OU wasn't going down easy, scoring on back-to-back drives, both capped with 50-plus yard passes from Dylan Gabriel. Going into the fourth quarter, Kansas State still had the lead, 27-20. OU tried to get back into the game, but too little, too late. Sooners score with 35 seconds remaining, but the Wildcats came out on top, 41-34.
Heading up to our neighbors to the north, the Kansas Jayhawks were looking to keep their undefeated season alive against Duke. Jalen Daniels and the Jayhawks have been one of the most electric offenses in college football, and they keep that going with a 73-yard pass to Daniel Hineshaw Jr. It was a back-and-forth game, but Daniels got a 3-yard run, his fourth touchdown of the game, to put Kansas up 35-20 in the fourth. Duke put one more score on the board, but it's not enough, and Kansas won 35-27. The team is now 4-0. I repeat, the Kansas Jayhawks are 4-0 in football. Never thought I'd say that.
Another Big 12 thriller was the Texas Tech game in Lubbock. Spoiler alert, this was the only overtime game in the conference last week. Texas was up by 2 touchdowns with 4:27 left to go in the third. But Texas Tech wasn't going down easy. The Red Raiders tied the game with a 19-yard touchdown pass and made a 45-yard field goal to take the lead, thinking they had the win secured. But Texas nailed a 48-yarder as time expired, forcing overtime. Bijan Robinson fumbled the ball on Texas' first possession, setting up a game-winning 20-yard field goal from Trey Wolf. The Red Raiders get the overtime victory, making Joey McGuire just the second Texas Tech head coach to get his first victory against the Longhorns on the first game.
And finally, taking a look at our competition this week, the Baylor Bears traveled up to Ames to take on the Iowa State Cyclones. The Bears controlled this game for the majority, up by 10 going into the fourth. Bears receiver Gavin Holmes caught a 38-yard touchdown pass from Blake Shapen to put Baylor up 17 with under 10 minutes to go. Iowa State did have a valiant comeback effort, putting up a touchdown and a field goal, but it was not enough, and Baylor gets its first win in Ames since 2016. Jace, I don't know about you, but I'm thinking the Big 12 conference may be the most interesting Power 5 conference this season.
Oh, I totally agree. I mean, like you said, who would have predicted that Kansas would have a better record than OU and Baylor to start the season?
Not me, that's for sure, but I'm not upset about it. There is one more OSU sport that deserves some airtime. While it may not be spring yet, that has not stopped Cowgirl softball from getting some action. Our own Connor Bergen has a story.
Fall ball has made its return in Stillwater. The Cowgirls will compete in a total of 8 games over the next month, giving a chance for incoming and returning players to get valuable reps before the regular season kicks off near March. Following their last season home opener matchup against the USAO Drovers, the Cowgirls will travel to Kansas City for back-to-back games against the University of Kansas City and Wichita State this Saturday. Following that, the Cowgirls will head to Wichita to face off against the Shockers once again, before finishing off the fall ball season with 4 consecutive home matches.
While it's valuable for the Cowgirls to get these early reps into the fall ball season, head coach Kenny Gajewski, the talent isn't the main concern going into these games. It's all about the level of competition that he sees from his squad.
You can talk about it and kids can tell you what you want to hear, but the bottom line is when they get out between those lines, what happens? I want competitive people here. That's what I want to see.
For OSU, this is a valuable time to begin to take a closer look into some of the newest additions to the roster. 14 of them, to be exact. highlighted by transfers Lexi Kilfoyle from Alabama to the former Big Ten leader in batting average with Rachel Becker from Purdue. These games are valuable opportunities for this Cowgirl roster to mesh together before the regular season begins. For some of the returning Cowgirls, these fall games are an opportunity to get a better look at some of their new teammates in action.
In the next five games, I think it's just going to see where everybody, because he's going to be mixing people, different positions, just to see where people fit in, and I think it's just going to be good. The fall's fun. It's going to get to see everybody and see what they can do in like a game situation.
Reporting from Stillwater for the Poke Report, I'm Connor Bergen.
Thank you, Connor. If you want to learn more about the team's newest additions, make sure to check out Cowgirl Softball on Twitter. As our show is starting to come to a close, Jace, I know you've been dying to share something about the history between Baylor and OSU.
Yes, I have been. Throughout this week, I've gotten to take a look at some key matchups between the Bears and the Cowboys as their road to rivalry continues.
Oklahoma State and Baylor are playing in their 42nd matchup this Saturday in a series that dates back to 1914. This will be the fifth ranked matchup since the infamous 2013 game, where the rivalry between the Cowboys and the Bears started.
In 2013, an undefeated and fourth-ranked Baylor team came into Boone-Pickens Stadium with aspirations of a BCS national championship on their mind.
But that all changed when Baylor quarterback Bryce Petty fell at the one-yard line, failing to secure the first points of the game.
Got off to a good start, and Bryce Petty was running for the end zone, and nobody was around him. And like you said, the turf monster jumped up and tripped him, and he didn't score. And it was kind of like, uh-oh.
Oklahoma State ended up winning that 2013 game 49-17, putting that matchup on the map. Since that meeting, Baylor has been in control, winning six of the last nine games. Throughout the past 9 years, there have been many memorable games, most notably the 2015 game, where Baylor flipped the script and defeated a fourth-ranked, undefeated OSU team. Although most games have been very close, Oklahoma State has had two blowout wins against Baylor, in 2017 winning 59-16, and in 2020 winning 42-3. The last regular season matchup was in BPS 364 days ago, where the Cowboys outlasted the Bears 24-14.
Now the most recent matchup between the Cowboys and the Bears was right here at AT&T Stadium, where Oklahoma State was this close from being Big 12 champs.
I was heartbroken, you know what I mean? It was a tough loss. Disappointed that we couldn't get, you know, from the 1 yard line inside the five, somewhere in there, we couldn't rush it in.
With the departure of Oklahoma and Texas from the conference, we may see the birth of a new rivalry in the Big 12. Expect to see more games with higher stakes.
That leads us to here, McLean Stadium, where Oklahoma State is seeking revenge from that unfortunate Big 12 championship game. Well, Alex, I know the pressure is on for Oklahoma State for this game, but it's also on for us. We got to make our predictions. What's your score for this game?
So as of right now, the Bears are favored by 2 points, and the over-under is about 56.5 points, so it's going to be a high-scoring game for sure. I have the Cowboys coming out on top, but it's pretty close, 42-38. I wouldn't be surprised if the Bears take control of the game and lead even into the fourth quarter, but I have faith in the OSU Cowboys.
Well, I'm going to give the OSU faithful a big confidence boost. Oklahoma State wins this one 42-21. Spencer Sanders has his best game of his career here at McLean this Saturday.
Sanders has had a near historic season already, so I wouldn't be surprised if we see him show off on Saturday.
Well, I think that about does it for our show, as we are happy you joined us here in Waco, Texas. For the Poke Report, I'm Jace Andrews.
And I'm Alex Dusky.
Go Pokes!